office practice, a very successful practice in Barcelona, and I'm saying that he is young, beautiful, and bold, and all these very nice things, basically because we know very well that in Europe it's very difficult nowadays as a young professional to set up a practice that is really successful and that is really able to connect the possibilities of real projects with research. And I think that is what Carmelo has been basically working on for many years, and he succeeded in that because he has many real projects, but he's always trying to introduce new ideas of digital fabrication, research on design, parametric design, but also working in different scales, like from very small interior designs to the landscape scale. And it's a big pleasure to have him as a faculty, and it's a big pleasure to see his work going all over the city and outside the city. So thank you very much, Carmelo, for your contribution.
Thank you very much, Reti.
Please help me welcome Carmelo Zappulla.
Thank you very much, really, because as introduction, and somehow today I need it. So I thought that there were the possibility of going to a psychologist, but for my ego, it's even better to receive your great. So I'd like to thank the Institute of Advanced Architecture of Catalonia, and especially the academic director Areti e Marco Polu. And I was thinking that Marco Polo is quite Italian, no? It's like Marco Polo. And the academic coordinator Matilde Marengo, and the director of communication Silvia Brandi. Being here is like being at a good friend's place, no? And I'm pleased to see that many students came today. The lecture that I prepared for today is related with the concept of techno pattern, and the lecture is a little bit too long, but perhaps we'll get through it, and I will try to explain in an introduction, like the theoretical level of the lecture, and where I try to bring some observations that I theorized during my PhD thesis at the UPC. And the second part, which is the main part of the lecture, is about five selected works of external reference that I developed in the last 4 years. And what these projects share is the fact that they are related with the relationship between technology and pattern. So, question of the project cannot dispense with the logic of its materialization. In fact, technology often fosters the formal development of the project and unfolds its true essence. For this reason, its material behavior and technique inform the architectural project from its conceptual foundations to its final realization. And by technique, we intend those practical procedures, results of a certain know-how that perform a specific activity. Where with the word technology, we introduce the theoretical dimension of the practical process, which is the knowing why. No? So we have the know-how and the know why. And in the question concerning technology, the philosopher Heidegger, I'm not a very fan of Heidegger, but in this book, I really share this idea of techné, which is not primarily concerned with the idea of assembling or making or using tools and machines, but rather with the phenomenon of revealing. So therefore, technology is not a mere means, but a way of unveiling, of bringing forth. So it's connected with the idea of poiesis, no, with the idea of creation. In this lecture, I'd like to talk about technology in terms of material revealing as part of the creative process in architectural design. So if we define architecture as a complex system in which all the components, all the key factors are interconnected, or is rather the result of the interaction between endogenous and exogenous levels, pattern is the device that allow us to make this level interact. So in order to integrate these levels, we need a pattern, which is by the definition of Capra, the pattern is a graphic configuration of relationship that operates between the abstract and the practical dimension. So the pattern is at the same time the organizational scaffolding that precedes the creative act and its further consequence. And patterns are everywhere. Even when we learn to walk, we discover a pattern, which is an ordered movement which allows us to walk. Or even when we learn to talk, we are learning a pattern of words that together have a meaning. And so what we are seeing now is the system of dance notation by the choreographer Fouillet for the saraband. What is interesting here is that it's a system that is based on the pattern of the dance indication below, and it corresponds to the bar lines in the music score. So we see how a visual abstract pattern can describe the real patterns executed in music and dance. And of course, dance or music are neither in the indication nor in its execution. An automatic piano cannot replace the interpretation, the sensation, the creative execution of a piano player. And music, like dance or design, is something more. No, it's also connected to the emotional and sensible world. And patterns are repeating configuration of geometrical shapes that are flexible enough to grant the architect freedom to introduce variation required by external conditions. And within a system of architectural relationships, they are useful for establishing coherence. And his marvelous book on patterns, Picover, argued that art and size are not very much apart, because they share the same objectives. And with the spread of computational graphics, the distance between the two areas is really decreased. In fact, both artists and scientists use scientific tools and algorithms to represent natural and artistic objects. And when it comes to connecting art, science, and design, there cannot be better inspiration than Leonardo da Vinci. In fact, understanding a phenomenon for him meant connecting it with other phenomena through similar patterns. And when he studied the proportion of the human body, he compared them to the proportion of the buildings. And his investigation of muscles and bones led him to study and draw gears and levers, interlinking so the animal physiology with engineering. And studying the patterns of turbulence in water led him to observe similar patterns in the flow of air, from there he went to explore the nature of sound, the theory of music, and the design of musical instruments. So in scientific and mathematical research, patterns emerge as a formal diagrams of organization that study relations. In the words of Fridtjof Capra, there are two approaches to understand the world which have been in competition with one another throughout the history of philosophy and science. The first approach starts with the question, what is it made of? And in this case, you study building blocks, you study components, you study matter. The other approach starts with the question, what is the pattern? And when you study the pattern, you're studying relationships. And Capra synthesized both approaches because if you want to understand life, you need both. So we need the pattern dimension, which generates the relationship within the system. You need the material dimension, but you also need a third dimension, which is the process, which is the activity necessary to materialize the pattern. So we will see in the next five projects where is very strong the dialogue between the concept, the prior formal exploration, and its constructive rationalization. And when it comes with fabrication, I'm interested in the relation between the control over construction through digital manufacturing and the warm imperfection of the manual labor. So historically, the constructive textures of bricks have always had a fundamental importance in architecture, determining innovative structural system. And digital manufacturing today provides the possibility to re-experience this complexity by replacing the lost craft capacity. And that's why I like to compare these two images, in which we have the Karagan Twin Towers built in Iran in 1053, and the Gallery of Winery by Gramazio Kohler. So in the next project, we will see how the dot pattern can be implemented in different projects. So in this case, we use like a diffuse, like an homogeneous distribution of dots, where we that we implement by erasing and implementing the dot sides, so as to allow the circulation and to inform the dots with the different functions. So the first project is the pavilion that we designed for IOTA devices at the Mobile World Congress in 2013 to present a mobile phone with a double screen. And so we work with this dot regular pattern, and the open space would be used for the exhibition of the product. And this aim to generate a sensorial experience at the same time, because they want the client want to generate an experience for the user that visited the stand. So we have to think that it's very expensive to participate to this fair, so it's important to have to produce a wow effect. So in this case, we began to analyze the customer needs, and the idea is to generate a sort of landscape, a living sculpture, creating a completely transparent architecture. So in the project, the dots became a road system, and road changed its thickness according to its structural, and to integrate other elements of the project, such as showcases or furnitures. And to exhibit these innovative products, and also to induce a deep sensory experience by two architectural operations. The first is to we define a shelter characterized by the deployment and the sliding of two continuous surfaces. So the spatial container gives a response to all scales of the program. And secondly, we complete the space contained by these two surfaces with a forest of metal roads. All the structural elements are integrated. So this operation will allow to detect the boundaries of the pavilion without closing it visually, transparency without using transparent material. So we get maximum visibility without creating a sealed space detached from outside. All the components of the project were prefabricated and assembled on site. Here we have the different strips and the two surfaces of the ceiling and the floor. We start with the assembling of the floor slabs and the arrangement of the pillars. And once the pillars are fixed, we start to assemble the ceiling slabs. Here you see the skeleton of the pavilion almost ready. And with the two functional boxes of the kitchenette and the mapping room that works also as a stiffening element into the pavilion. Afterwards, we start to close the functional rooms and to place the roads in the exhibition space. So these vertical steel roads are generating also the boundaries of the pavilion. And the sensorial experience is delivered to the programmation of the and the interactive design of the light that was made in collaboration with Alex Posada. He's also a faculty in this school. There is no music here. Sound. So the wood project should be thought as a permeable interactive sculpture, a forest with hanging capsules containing devices, and for displaying the products. So they, at the same time, showing the products and playing with the light. Here you can appreciate how the capsule is showing the products. And this is the process of assembling that was made in, by Major Design. So we first heat the acrylic. Then we vacuum forming the piece. This adapting completely to the mold. So the roads not only play with the artistic level of the product, but also with the structural level, as some roads are thicker as they provide structural support. So there's a few of the stairs leading to the meeting room. The custom-made furniture will be used as a base station for presenting the IOTA phones and the connectivity devices. Here are some images of the fabrication process. There's a view of the base station. And a close-up of the connectivity devices base station. So apart from the architectural operation, we also incorporated a 3D mapping room that was made in collaboration with Onion Lab, where we explained the concept of the new product. So here we see how this gesture is allowing you to use both sides of the of the mobile. Thank you. So this time we still work in the next project, we still work with a dot pattern, but introducing a radial gradient orientation and topographic deformation. And one year after realizing the first Yota Pavilion, we tried to produce another different immersive experience to the visitors. So we are still in the Mobile World Congress space, and more of an exhibition space than a booth. The whole project should be thought as a techno landscape that is defining a topography. And behind this topography, we have all the technical spaces. So this is the side view where you can appreciate the relationship between the ceiling and the lower landscape. And this is one of the final visualization that has been shown to the client. And this is the realization. We could explain the project as a combination of three different patterns according to three different elements: the ceiling, the exterior cladding, and the ribs topography. So let's talk more in detail about the ceiling. These are the polycarbonate tubes used for the ceiling construction. They are 2,200 meters of tubes with a diameter of 14 millimeters. And this is the graphical algorithm that has been used for shaping the topography. And this is the plan where we show the geometrical array of the tubes of the topography. So the distribution is not homogeneous, but it's following a radial gradient oriented toward the visitor. Here you see that every tube has a code number and a length, and in red are the lead strips length. So here is the organization of which allows to optimize the position and the orientation of all ceiling tiles inside of the acrylic panels. For cutting the tubes, we have the same problem of material optimization. In fact, we have 2,100 tubes with different lengths that must be cut from polycarbonate tubes of 3 meters. So for this reason, the length data recollected previously have been organized in order to optimize the length of different parts within the entire tube and keeping the numeration code of each part. So at the same time, the algorithm produced labels that can be placed on the different tubes part. So this file has been used for measuring and coding every single tube of the topography. And this is the final result. So we cannot change the position of the tubes, of course, because every tube contributes to the generation of the entire topography. And this is the pattern that defines the cladding of the pavilion. The verticality of the cloud tubes continue on the wall, materializing a topographical pattern. The computational side of the project, we received the help of Carlos Bausa, now that you also know. This pattern allows to increase or decrease the permeability of the walls in order to control the porosity of the cladding. An algorithm has been used to introduce the level curves into a dot pattern. So the dots are codified through the deepness of the conical drill that will mill the panel. So according to the position of the point, we have also an overlapping of the dots that generates like unpredicted results. So these are the points that will inform the CNC and C milling machine. We have superficial erosion, the open erosion, and the big erosions. And this is the CNC milling machine from Medio Design during the cutting process. It is interesting how the same information can be manipulated in a creative way through several steps from the concept to the realization. Here is Juan Pablo from Media Design that is programming the cladding panels. And these are the cladding panels during the assembling. Outside, we have this techno landscape, which is the result of this erosion. And this is the effect of the light coming out through the pattern. So as I said before, the use of ribs is the third operation that defined the project. the orientation of the ribs is facing the visitor in order to optimize the visualization of the devices that are displayed. So also here we need to optimize the ribs and the floor tiles within the MDF panels. These are the components that define the ribs. All the ribs were primed and painted before the assemblage. This is the assembly during all the ribs are interconnected with the spacers, and this is the phase before covering everything with the fabric. So these ribbons rebuild the smooth, clear, and sensual interior surface. And it embodies all the needs of the pavilion through simple ribbons deformation. So on one hand, the size increasing for encapsulating the devices. On the other hand, the size reduction for integrating the projection areas. So for instance, on the left, we have the technical rooms, and on the right, we have the meeting room. More images. So here we see how we encapsulate the devices. So we have a classification of the different items and their capsules. So according to the content, we have different kind of capsules and different brackets and finishing for the vacuum forming. So we heat the acrylic, we take out from the oven, which is a pizza oven. We adapt it over the mold, and we turn on the vacuum, and so the acrylic adheres completely to the mold. And after we place the frame in its position, we cut out the capsules. These are the capsules. These are the brackets that we place inside, and all the fixing elements. Well, I mean, this is the video. The capsules are integrated within the same system. So we see here not two ribs deformation. We enlarge for encapsulating the devices, or we blur for opening some screen projection. This is an image from the technical room, because sometimes we have a very small space. We need some mirrors for enlarging to the size that we need. So the ribs behave like a single mass, and this is the position of the speaker where he can choose different music and lighting programs. And these are some pictures taken during the event where more than 10,000 people visited the pavilion. It was quite crowded. Here you can see from the video the main purpose of the booth, which is inducing this deep sensory experience through loud light, music, and projection. And from the design to the construction, this period was 2 months. It was quite tough to deliver in time the pavilion. Also, the music was designed on purpose. So, La Fura del Baus is a Spanish theatrical group, which was founded in 1979. And they are really famous for their urban theater, the use of unusual settings, and blurring the boundaries between audience and actors. All the action produced a dialogue between the architectural level, the audience, and the evolution of the actors. And according to a review of their London performance published in NME, La Fura del Bauhaus create a kind of adult adventure, playground of fun, danger and fantasy. So I want to show the project of the office of La Fura del Bauhaus for two reasons. First of all, because the Fab Lab here collaborated to the construction. Secondly, because they are your neighbors, because they are just in front of here. And thirdly, because they are one of the most famous theater company in the world. So for La Fura del Bauhaus, we imaged a visceral space called funnel. And where we could weave a pattern of light, structure, and space, where the limits between acting and working are blurred. So we made a fluid and continuous space determined by an object, no, that that digests its visitors, and where different activities can be performed. So it is an object within another object, within a space, so it generates its own space, and at the same time, the space of the residual areas, no, which is used mainly as a storage. So this is the vestibule of the space, a sort of welcoming area where several scenographic elements are displayed, and where projections take place. And this is the materialization of the original idea of weaving lighting threads. So it is a sort of space-time tunnel. It's like analysis rabbit hole, no, wherein you fall into a creative and unpredictable world. The limited budget pushed us to reinterpret the ephemeral identity of the project. So instead of using CNC banded tubes, we use planar ribs, no, that replace the more expensive tubular arches. So the different pieces were milled here in the Fab Lab, ribs with the lighting pipes and the clips, the brackets that are fixing the these tubes. Everything is designed like a meccano. We don't cover any constructive details, so it is thought with the aesthetic of a construction kit. We also reduce the funnel space to one third of the total area, adding the exhibition vestibule. The tunnel is made of portion of circular arches that change smoothly. And then we have three moments where the radius are changing dramatically in order to produce the opening to the residual spaces. So here you can see, you know, how the tunnel is open to the residual space with the copy machine, printers, etc. And here from the other side, this is a view of the director of the of La Fura del Bauhaus, Carlos Padrissa, through the structure. Here you see all the components, you know, that are constituting the structure. And this is a view from the bookcase to the window. And this is a view from the storage area. So let's move. We are still in Barcelona. We move center in Sant Antoni neighborhood. And we are in the second floor of the historical building of the old Fabrica Moritz. It was established in 1864. And it's a place also renowned for the refurbishment of by the famous architect Jean Nouvel. And before moving to the main project that I want to show you, I'd like to show also two installations that we designed for Louis 1856 in the Fabrica Moritz context. So the first installation is a spiral of bottles that grows over a specular table. It is designed following the constraints of the space, determining the end of the bar of the Baravins space. So this is a view from the arch, and this is a view when you arrive, I mean, you will have the bathroom on the left when you finish the stair. So we have this installation of wine bath bowls. And on the other side, we have the second installation, which is a beer hive. It's a dot pattern, which is informed by an infill accumulation plus a topographical displacement. In fact, this is it's a circle packing wherein the cylinders that house the bottles are stacked one on top of the other. And the requirement was to create a sort of filter. At the beginning, they wanted just a curtain for separating the two spaces. So we propose, of course, to make something more. And we make the installation in which it is working like a screen. So this is how the topography is. Then at the end, we reduce the displacement. And the displacement became lighter. We have a bench into the bottom for waiting. And this is the view from the stair. And this is a view where you see the different components and the permeability of the installation. Because from one side, they want to make a filter. On the other side, the other requirement was to have a sort of visibility of the existing space. So the other problematic element was the holder, because we need like an elastic holder, because the cylinder are not, I mean, they seem the same, but they're not exactly the same. So we need something that you can pull, so elastically you can introduce inside and at the same time fix the bottle. And we have like three different kind of bottles. We have wine bottles, beer, and also craft beer. Here you see the video. The reality is not that dynamic, it's lower, because otherwise the client was afraid that it can disturb, you know, during the... So now I will show you for the first time the pictures of the manufacturing process of the Michelin-starred restaurant Alchimia of the chef Jordi Villa. It is going to open in 2 weeks. Let's see. Before talking about the project, I'd like to thank also the people that worked in this project, especially Churros for the art direction, and of course Stuart Max and Elena Mitrofanova, that was I mean, ex-students of IAAC, and also Edward Elpas, and now he's talking, but he's also Elpas a couple of weeks. So these are the images taken 1 year ago of the space where the restaurant will take place. So as you can see, it's a beautiful, beautiful place, full of history, which belongs to the heritage of the city. For this reason, we want to establish a particular relationship between the existing space and our design, the restaurant is thought as a series of scenographic accidents that together build the continuity of an experience. So that's why I want to show the project as a journey. So we enter from that place, which is the yellow dot. So it is important to think about the user experience from the very first moment. We enter a mysterious and dark space in which you forget your day life and you start a new sensorial experience where flavor, fragrance, and aesthetic perception can take you to unknown places. You walk beside the wall glowing crack, whose light guide you through the space. And at the end of the hallway, we have the logo of the Alchemia, which is sculpted onto the wall, producing a textured mural animated by a dynamic projection. Then we pass by the cloakroom and we get to the reception area. So this is the cloakroom. Whose morphology comes from the study of fish vertebrae. All the project is a sort of homage to the world of fishes, because it's mainly a restaurant where fish is cooked, and so we have this serialization of flat vertebrae that are producing the gaps for storing the clothing. This is the first prototype. So here you see how the morphology is optimum for placing the hanging tubes, and the tube itself will project light through the to the cloth. And we get to the reception area. So it is an art installation made of bottled food samples contained into long glazing tubes. So which reminds the Natural Science Museum, where different specimens are exposed, but this time we expose food, basically. You know, so it's like the all the collection of food by the chef. So the installation should be thought as an inventory of the Jordi Vilas ingredients. So there are different levels of the installation, the electric circuit, and these are the different levels of the of the installation. Here the plan that shows the superposition of the different levels, and these are some pictures of the prototype. At the moment we have just a few pipes where we combine the 3D mapping with the LED LED, also in this case would be programmed, and the combination of LED light with the liquid and the projection produce this kind of holographic effect. At the moment, we will have also an object, a real object inside. And these are different tests that we are doing at the moment. So we go to the backbone of the project, which is closer to the restaurant itself. And this is the spine. It's what we call the spine. So we make reference to the word of fishes, and so we remember now the biodiversity of the fish and the importance of the morphology. So from the study of Darcy Thompson, no, we realize how the constraints are changing the morphology, generating different species. So from here, we generate our fish, which is a sort of interpretation of a spine. And according to the constraints of our space, we generate our project. Yeah, the different species that we study and we merge into the design. So this is like the level zero of the fish. we adapted to the space, firstly in the two dimensions, and then in the three dimensions. And these are all the constraints that of the space, so the existing beams. The doors, the existing doors. So we transform it in the three dimensions, and then we add all the structure. So this is the fish spine that invades the hallway, opening towards the J bar space on the left. So in this explode axonometric view, we see the different components of our spinal column with the vertebrae, which is flexible enough to cover the corridor ceiling, integrating the light system. And here the fins that covers the J bar ceiling and separate the alchemia restaurant at the same time. So the separation happens through 17 programmed fins that are motorized, that can control the permeability between the two spaces. So these are some details, and here the detail of the mechanical fins with the motors that control the opening. We are still working on the simulation with Beta Robotics. We are working with some spring hinges, so we are reducing the motors. At the beginning, we were thinking having like 17 different motors that can be programmed, but now with this configuration, we can have just one motor that is synchronized with the four fins. So you move one fin, and then the rest from the shaft through these spring hinges, you can move also the others. So we use the existing beams for hanging the spine structure without touching the ceiling. And this is the result of the complex, I mean, what you see is the result of a complex process before of the design, before its construction, where we change many different version and slightly adjusting everything to the space and to the client's needs. As you can imagine, it's a complex process of dialogue that implies a deep computational study of the morphology and its fabrication. The construction is based on a scaffolding, a substructure of different ribs. These are pictures that we took at Media Design, where also Martin was collaborating. Every piece is different and is inclined, so the inclination of the ribs change continuously. So it's nevertheless, once the protocol of fabrication is clear, the process of assembling becomes easy. These are the different the skeleton parts of the different fins. These are the longer fins that will occupy the J-bar space. I will go faster because there are so many. You already know how a CNC machine works, so you don't need to see it. But what is interesting here is that a sort of new composite material was designed for allowing the wood achieving this kind of curvature. So we embedded into the wood a layer of fabric, a very thin fabric, follow the curvature of the vertebrae. These are the end of some of the vertebrae, and here you see now the pattern of the unfold, like in the when you make the pattern for your clothes, no? And so here you see how the flexible part is connected with the rigid side of the vertebrae, and then you see all the details for connecting every single piece flashed, and these are the structure that stay behind the piece. So here we are revealing the all the construction elements, but the clients want to hide it somehow because they think this was cleaner. I mean, these were different tests, no? Or even having the same pattern continuously, or separating only where you need. Many pictures of the fabrication. These are one of the longest fin, and these are the fins ready now when we have the veneer that is covering everything perfectly and ready for the assembling. So if we zoom out the fish spine, we see a shoal of fishes, and which becomes our graphic abstraction that surround the Alchimia space. So we enter into the restaurant itself, and the fishes became like perforation that reveal the existing space. So they play a symbolic meaning and the new inner skin of the project at the same time. So this is where like the renders that we were showing to the client. And so they are interacting with the existing elements of the history, like here where we see the chimney or the floors, because they want to protect all the existing elements, like the floors. We cannot use the existing floors, and so we have to cover it. And at the same time, we want to show some details of the original floors. So that's how the show revealing the existing pattern of the room. So it is important to establish this kind of dialogue between the old and the new, where the language emerged is unpredictable. And at the same time, we do the same thing with the walls. So under the topography of the show, we reveal portions of the most relevant elements of the space. So we make different tests with the lights. And these are the platforms that we're going to use for the floor. I know that you know how it's nice to see when we zoom in, because you will understand how it is designed, because just the same drill is producing all the pattern following some path, just changing the deepness. So it is quite fast to produce the final pattern. They are just paths that are carving the panels. It's a spherical mill. So these are like, let's say, three different panels. Also, the way in which we separate the panels are following these lines. So you will see the different panels, and you will see the joint. but this joint will follow the same strategy. And then at the end, it will be covered completely by a big layer of resin, of transparent resin, that will protect everything, but without touching the floor. So we will have first a layer of plastic, a membrane first, and then we will put the resin on top. So we are inside of the, we are literally surrounded by these panels. And we pass now from the CNC cutting machine with five axes to the Chinese guy that helped us to Hola. To Hola. Take the, yes. the table. No, el chatarrero was quite nervous because he didn't know that I was the owner of the table. So this is the table. So this is the table. The peculiarity of this table is that you can adjust the height of the. So it's a sort of steampunk element. Everything is laser cut, but it's something very common in metalworks. So we have like a big weight on the bottom to for the stabilization of the thing. This is how it's working. So you first screw the thing, and then you can fix it. I was saying stop, but it was continuing. But so now we finally screw it. So these are the tops of the tables. At the end, it will be covered by. So at the end, it's not a big deal. So this is the J bar, when you can see the preparation bar on the right, then the sofa, and another selection of food. So food conserves are stored and exposed on these glazing containers, which are built on purpose. So we will show, I hope, something nicer than. This route, but I think that it was looking nice for the presentation. So here we have the installation of the J bar. The installation of so we have these different shelves, and these are the glazing containers that we designed on purpose in the Biddafog, the place that you know. You had the very good experience. So these are the pieces, then the table bar that can be combined in different configurations. And then there's something interesting for you probably, which is the aluminum cast fabrication for the legs. I will go directly to the video. Yes, which is this. I speed it up. It was nice to have like Benny Hill music in the background. So it's working like this. We have like two metal boxes where we put sand. It's a specific sand which is very compact. At the end, it became like a sort of clay. So we put it on top of the mold, which is the positive. So we basically give them one piece, which is the leg, and then they make the first, let's say the negative of the piece. Then they have the positive. And then the place, the two boxes. You see that the sand doesn't come out because it's very compact. Then they put it on the top. And then they pour the aluminium. You only have to consider that there's a contraction of the material, so you have to make the piece a little bit bigger, and then you have some angles for disassembling the the piece without destroying the sand. So respecting these two things, then everything will go quite smooth. A different test of different finishing of the table. And the chair is another chapter, is another big chapter, because you think that it's easy to make a chair, but it's not. Especially when you don't have a very big budget. So you say, okay, but I can make it with 3D printing. So I can make different pieces and then you can assemble it. This doesn't match very well, so you have to add plaster, then you have to put the coating. It's a very long process, in which I participated manually in. This is the stool. So we split the pieces, you build different pieces. I was here desperating for finishing the model. And then at the end of this, we used this for producing the first piece of aluminium. So at the moment it's super heavy because it's just the mold that we will use for making the other the series. Another mold for subtracting the weight, so at the end the legs will be empty inside. This is the sofa. Also here there's another very long process, first of design. We were experimenting beginning, like different shapes, different techniques. This was in wood, but it was not very comfortable. Then we switched to something like lighter, visually lighter. And in the end, I think that were like 40 different tests before getting to the final one. So there was another proposal in which it was closing one side of the space, reducing it. And at the end, this was, you know, the, let's say, the final configuration. So we made it this way. At the moment, it's the Apple's chair is putting all the foam and the leather. Then over the sofa, we have a projection, a 3D mapping on top of these pieces. I mean, this top down. But all these dots are these pieces that you see here. So it would be a wall covered by these kind of dots. And on the aluminium, we will project the images. So it would be like a sort of an artistic projection. It's we won't show like a Barcelona playing football. Okay. So this is the preparation bar. It's a preparation bar in which you have a container for the ice and the bottles of some alcohols. Then you have a door, and then you have two trolleys that are used for the preparation onto the tables. No, so they will finish your dish in your table. So you take out this, and this is the way in which they are producing it. They are doing it in Italy. So here you see the system of production. And then at the end, they have to polish all this. They are already, they have the time to some more recent image. And this is the bathroom. So again, we come back to the idea of the fish scales to build our tiny bathrooms. At the end, we have only this surface with these mirrors that are constructing one phase of the space, and called the rehydration sink. You know, was inspired us for designing the two sinks, these for boys and these for girls, which is more essential, no? And this is the mirror installation. So your image will be fragmented in these scales, which are quite big, so they are big enough to see your face in any case. So, and the construction is very easy because we are have just shelves, and then we have an element that is changing this orientation, nothing else. So this is what we how we image these bathrooms. Yeah, the idea was having a pipes coming out from the ceiling, so it's not like a sink, but it's more like a fountain, which you go there and then you do your business. So here we are in the gallery. In the gallery we have a very simple table that are fixed to the existing windows. So we have this system of lighting. Now we have the existing elements of the carpentry, and here we fix a sort of T in which we have two LED, and then the simple tables. And then outside we have a gallery cabinets, which are quite gothic. It's like an organ, no? In which we have T profiles that are producing at the same time this kind of installation into the walls, revealing sometimes part of the existing wall. And then we have we integrate shelves, we integrate places for hanging the glasses, and here we have some drawers. Okay, so these are the two elements, and then we go into another element that is the wine room that is using the same profiles. So in this way, not just the extrusion of these, this was the first one in which we were using some cross shapes, but then we changed it with something that is already in production, which is the conventional T. And at the same time, it's producing, you know, this sort of cave full of wines. These are the some images of the of the construction. This is Juancito who is cutting. See, it doesn't go. When I was looking at it, I say, look at this guy, he's taking his time, no? Like, okay, now I don't know if the time we are going well, because we can decide or to finish now or to showing another project, which is the last. Yeah? Okay. So the last one is, I mean, as you put this image as a background, you know, I say, okay, let's show it. This exhibition was a competition that we won for the Spanish Pavilion for the Yeosu Expo in Korea in 2012, which was about oceans and coast, and the slogan was the living coast and oceans, diversity of resources. And Spain names its exhibition Spain Explores, calling attention to its unrivaled tradition of geographical exploration and scientific discovery. The mission is to showcase Spain's nautical discoveries by turning a didactical exhibition into a sensory experience, which aims to go to the heart of the visitor. So the exhibition project consists of three main stages. The central space, I mean, the architecture of the pavilion was already designed and built. So the central space with this circular wall was already there. And in this space, we show the three key moments in Spanish seafaring map on the left, and then the deep ocean, which is the central part. So we go here, and the circle is split in two parts by an imaginary horizon. And to the top, we have a didactic projection, and an interactive show into the lower one. And the three expeditions are explained in details by the three magic glasses. You see, these are the magic glasses in which you can show the real and the physical object inside of these boxes, and then you have a dynamic graphic that is informing you. So we were showing Columbus, Malaspina, which are not Spanish, but they were working for Spain. And ultimately, the Malaspina 2010 expedition that was carried out by the Espeides crew. And so we used the glazing element as I mean, we used the idea of tubes as a sample for collecting the data by this crew, and we transform it into the dot of our installation. In the last room, we have the MAXXI map, which is the Buckminster Fuller, the MAXXI map that we reinterpreted for having a sort of more democratic image of the world, especially because we were in Korea. So in this way, Korea is not just in the south, but it's in a reasonable position. And and we use the dot as a generative and informative pixel within this installation. So we have this unfolded world map where the data collected by the Malaspina expedition are projected. So the mapping contributes to generate also magical and moving atmospheres, as you can see here, by the 3D mapping of Onion Lab. All these are containers full of water. So if you see the projection of the water, it's a different effect. Yeah, we can project from the front because we have the height for projecting without generating shadows when you are very close to this. So it's a relation between the distance of the user, the position of the map, and the height of the projector. And here it's even more complicated. Of the project, which is the deep ocean. So the visitor will enter a space which is samples containing water collected at a depth of 5,000 meters. And the shape of the samples is reminiscent of the tubes used by Malaspina 2010 expedition. So on the other side, the dot became an informative water lamp that generates the deep ocean installation. So here I mean, this was the first time that we were experimenting this idea of topography and dots with a different position. So we have around 1,000 different, the container is always the same, but the position is changing. And the Korean guys messed up all the codes. So when I arrived, all the tubes with the different codes were completely mixed. And I want to die. And but they were so calm. They said, no problem. We're going to measure all the pieces. They make an Excel and comparing. I mean, it was like 1,000. So this is a view of the installation from the entrance, and here we are exactly in the middle of the deep ocean. As you can see here, the complexity of this project is that we have a combination of lights into the water pots. Then we have a projection here. This topography is made in a way that you you will never produce shadows into the projections, and we also have mapping onto these two areas. That's why in these two areas the topography is longer, no? So you will keep the distance from the projection area. And also the music, and there was also a Kinect for having some interaction. So these are the detail of the collecting tubes. So here they are welding two pieces of the wood with the blue fire. I mean, this image we're coming before, no? Because here we have the two tubes together, and then they melt the two pieces. The topography expands or shrink to regulate the flux of user. The user will find themselves, you know, immersed in this space full of colors, images, sound, which are synchronized, and which allow them to live the experience of being in the bottom of the sea. This is our interpretation. So this is a moment in which the installation became completely red. You will see it into the video. So one of the key features of this experience is the 3D mapping of the two sides, and we'll see it here. To conclude. Sometimes you... the 3D mapping on top of the water. So here the water was whiter, so we add some ink. This is the interaction.
So thank you very much, Carmelo. I don't know if you know, but we had a lecture with Edouard Cabet a couple of weeks ago, and he showed us a building that he did with wine. So I feel like maybe between our faculty, there's a common theme of alcohol and architecture emerging, possibly. I'd just like to invite anyone who might have any questions for Carmelo. No? Are you? Nobody? You already know him too well. Silvia Brandi.
Thanks, Carmelo, for the lecture.
Thank you.
Very, very nice. Let's see. I think it's very interesting for our students that you show your work, because it's really showing us going through all the fabrication process, and specifically digital fabrication process is informing the design continuously, and so and becomes part of the way you think the design. So I think it's in here is particularly interesting this. But what about the scale? Can we imagine to apply this process and this technology to a bigger scale? You know that here we make experimentations about 3D printing in great scale in construction. So how do you envision this? Is not part of your interest? It has not been an opportunity?
No.
Or is that you wouldn't know how to do it? How would you position it yourself towards this?
I'd love to make a bigger scale project, but it's these are the projects I get. I mean, I try. I mean, if you, it's much more complicated to applicate these things in a bigger scale. I mean, we are doing, for instance, now a house, no, a villa, blah blah blah, and we try to make a facade, but then it became so expensive that clients cannot afford it. So unless you are probably here, I mean, you don't have the client, the right clients here, but it's very complicated to. And I think that in a bigger scale, I mean, in all these projects, I worked as a constructor, because you don't have a constructor that can, that you give this project and then can build it. In a bigger scale, there are companies that are specialized in the facade. So you go there and, or to the optimization, even the optimization of the facade, like Portman, who is teaching in Vienna or and also at Kaust University in Jeddah. He's specialized in the approximation of the geometry. So according to your budget, you can decide to approximate your complex surface in a certain number of double curvature tiles or single curvature tile or flat tile. So according to your budget, you can have different configuration of your project. So there are very super specialized companies that are doing this. So yes, I'm super interested in making these things, but I didn't have the chance for doing so yet. No, and then what's happening is that if you're making a project, other projects like this will come. No, I mean, because your client will see this and say, "Ah, that's nice. Let's do." So, well, I mean, I hope that the life will be long and we will have more possibilities to change. I really like to make this project. I started to make with the external reference. We started with landscape design, landscape urbanism. Like we really started collaborating with foreign office architects. And we won a competition for the aerospace, and then we said, "Ah, very nice. Let's start to make this. Let's see if we're gonna win." So we made like three other master plans. We didn't win, but then the crisis arrived. So we changed completely the for surviving. We tried to find a niche into the market. And this is the niche that we found. So we are really proud and happy to make these things. Nevertheless, it would be very nice not to change the scale.
Hi, Carmelo.
Hi, Maite.
Thanks for the great lecture. I really enjoyed it. I have a few questions. Sorry, I arrived late. Maybe you already addressed this, but
yeah, I saw you arriving late. Yes.
Sorry, my apologies. I wanted to. I know that while you were developing this project, you were developing also your PhD thesis. So I'm interested in the relationship. How was the theoretical work instrumental to the development of your project? That's my
question. No, but I mean, I can make a.
But wait, I have more questions. The second question is related to the use of these kind of analogies with nature, and I know. And it's a little bit related to the question from Sylvia regarding the, I'm not so concerned about the scale, but for instance, the use of Darcy Thompson and the fish, and which, you know, it was also evident in the work of Frank Gehry because he started working with fishes, like, you know, the fish in here in the seaside of Barcelona was the starting point of a whole line of projects. But my question is related more into the performative aspects of natural, in this case, organisms, whether you have considered that in the development of your project. And the last question is related to materiality, because I very much enjoy that part of your presentation, the whole digital fabrication and especially the materiality, kind of discovering all these performative aspects and how they need to be embedded into the design and how they are in fact informing the design. And Mies van der Rohe, actually, when you say this comment of the chair, he said it was much more difficult to build a chair than to design a skyscraper. So the chair design as a topic of design is a completely complex, very complex topic. So, and I'm interested in you explaining how this materiality and fabrication has been informing your design. Sorry, a lot of questions.
So I will start with the last question, and then you will remember me the first. If I'm not able to do so. So the materiality, I think it's they're very interesting questions. There are two ways of addressing the design and the relationship between the materiality and the computation. The first one is that you first design something and then you find a way to build it, which is the most common. And the second one is that you open a sort of a feedback loop in which one thing is informing the other one, or even you already know you first know your tools, and according to the tools you make your design. For example, for the chair, I had in a previous project. It's a very small project. It's like a display for a bottle of gin, just for remaining in the topic of alcohol. So I was experimented the aluminium cast and the digital fabrication, because we made the mold with the digital fabrication, and then we used as a mold for a completely manual way of construction, which is a very very old technique, no? So I was fascinated by this dialogue, no, between something that is very, is an old technique, is an old technology, and something that is quite contemporary, no, because you're designing something that is on your computer, you build it, and then you use it and so from the very beginning, I knew that my chair had to be designed for the aluminium cast. So I had some constraints that I knew from the very beginning. Then of course you make the design, you talk with the provider say you yes, no, then you realize that it's too heavy, that you have to make it empty inside. So the process is very long. And but then at the end you have a sort of know-how that can be applied in different things, probably in the future, no, in the next design. I think that I will reuse this what I learned in this project. Now also, if you have seen the this last project of the Spanish pavilion, the idea of projecting into the water is used in the other project as a food containers, no? And the idea of having an object inside of the water. So these are like things that are coming back into the process. So probably this is about the material was pertinent, no? The answer. So the other question was about the morphology of the natural elements. In the natural elements, I think that there's no, I'm super interested in natural patterns, and I think that there's something, no, in your unconscious dimension that emerge and it's mixed, and then there's something that is conscious, no, which is like in the fish. I mean, in the fish it was a process. I'm talking about the fish spine. When I was showing, no, the video of the morphology. Sometimes you are designing something because you have your fish in your mind, and then you read back, I don't know, Darcy Thompson, and you realize that what you were doing, it's actually happening in nature, and so you're reinforcing it, and it gives you it's like a support, no, from other people, and you see, well, probably it's the good way. But it's not like a microscopic. In that case, it wasn't like a microscopic mimetic process, but it was more like an aspirational process in which, I mean, if I tell you that it's a fish, you understand that it's a fish. But if I don't say it, probably you think that it's another thing. No, I am always concerned about the literality of the things. So it's good that you have, especially in this kind of projects, people love stories. No, as architects, we are also always afraid about metaphors of symbology. No, because no, it's no. I mean, I'm the first. But clients love remember. I don't know that Yokohama remembers us like a wave. No, this was the way in which probably Alejandro Saera was selling the project to the client, but he never say to the in architectural book. So there's always this this dilemma, no? And probably sometimes it's I don't have any problems in projects like this to say that, I mean, it's a beer hive, no, or it's a fish spine, because the client will give, no, a meaning, because they don't have a design background, so they need to collocate your design in a scaffolding, no, in a theoretical or a metaphorical structure. And then the part of the theory, you know, the theoretical part, what I was saying is basically I was making a synthesis between the difference between technique and technology, you know, because the technique is the knowing how, and the technology is the knowing why. And I was saying that I give to the technology the importance of revealing. It's not just a mean, but it's something more. It's something that you like. I was talking about Heidegger, you know, that he was saying, you know, that the importance of technologies like the poiesis is not just the techne, but it's like a part of the creative process. And so technology is also a way for integrating different aspects, you know, which is the user aspect, which is the materiality, which is the program, the functioning, etc. So I was saying that the device, that the instrument that allow us as a designer to make all these elements to interact, because when you, anytime you wanna build something, no, because it's a sort of discretization of the materiality, and the pattern is not only in terms of geometrical system, question of relationships, no. So in this case, I was mentioning Fridtjof Capra and a bit more about. So basically, it's this, no.
I wanted to.
I want it as well. When it will be ready. At the moment, we are in the middle of the process. There are many problems that happen continuously. It's a quite expensive chair.
Okay, well, if there are no more questions, I'd like to invite you guys to thank Carmelo once again for his lecture. Thank you.
Thank you. So the refreshment will be served. No.